Now it's 6 o'clock and we come to a new series of Jazz File. Can you sing me a song? Helen Mayhew tells the story of one of the great saxophonists of the 20th century, Stan Getz. The programme begins with Gary Burton, Dave Gelly and Alan Shipton explaining the title.
His favourite story, which he told repeatedly during the years I knew him, was about touring with the Jazz at the Philharmonic with kind of all-star mini-musicians on a bus. And one night, Sonny Stitt
was walking up and down, I can't believe this, he was walking up and down the bus.
With all these, certainly his peers, and in some cases perhaps slightly more than that, sitting on the bus, he's the one who gets out his horn,
playing little bits of fast stuff and saying, how about that, huh?
And he goes on, and there's no reaction, especially from Lester Young, who has that pork pie hat of his pulled down over his eyes, and he's trying to get some rest on the bus. So finally,
he came up to Lester Young and asked him,
how about that, Prez? How about that, huh?
And Prez, without missing a beat, and probably without moving his hat, says,
that's very nice, Lady Stitt.
But can you sing me a song?
Stan Getz, and possibly his best-known recording, which was a pop hit in the early 60s, The Girl from Ipanema. And you can hear why that story of Lester Young and Sonny Stitt was one of his favourites. It's because, as in every record he ever made, he is singing a song. Brought bossa nova into the mainstream, he altered the consciousness of jazz forever. There is barely a musician since who hasn't used its beguiling rhythms at one time or another. And it wasn't the only time his music changed the face of jazz. His recording of Early Autumn defined the sound of cool and seduced a whole generation of tenor saxophonists. For more than four decades, he was held in the highest regard, both by jazz musicians and the public. She just doesn't see. Stan Getz was born in 1927 and brought up in the Bronx, a New York neighborhood which fully deserved its tough reputation. Music, for Stan, opened up the possibility of escape and the possibility of bringing in money to help support the household. He took up the saxophone in his early teens, and by the time he was 14, he was playing at weddings and bar mitzvahs for $3 a go. Dave Gelly is his biographer.
When Stan was 15 years old, he was pretty good. I mean, he could do all the things that a professional musician could do, and he actually got a job playing with a band in New York, until the school board found out and dragged him back to school again. And all the time he was thinking, he's got to get away. He really wanted to go with the band. He had a union card, he wanted to go with the band. And his friend said, I'm going to take an audition with Jack Teagarden's band. Why don't you come along? So Stan went along. Teagarden said, I want you to get a clean shirt and your toothbrush and be at Union Station at 10 o'clock tomorrow morning. And that's how Stan got into the business. Fortunately, his mother was away visiting relatives, or she would have stopped him. But his father let him go because he was rather intrigued by the amount of money he was going to be earning.
Jack even had to legally adopt Stan.
Vibraphone player Gary Burton, who played with Getz for 3 years in the 60s and heard all his life story.
In order to be legally safe touring around the different states. I mean, after all, this was a mixed-race band back in the 1940s. This was, you know, with a 15-year-old kid playing saxophone in it and so on. And Stan told me that he rode in the car with Jack and his wife, and the other band members rode in another car. So Jack and his wife kind of took care of Stan, almost treated him like a son of their own. And I think that meant a lot to Stan. Jack was a wonderful musician. He was somebody Stan could really look up to and learn from. And I know that you know, Jack's melodic style, Jack's general attitude toward life, was a very positive influence on Stan.
But according to Robert Black, classical saxophonist and friend of Stan's, Jack Teagarden's influence was also a musical one.
His sound, he said, was based when he was on the road with Jack Teagarden. He said, and Teagarden would say, you know, it's air and brass. And I'd stand back behind stage and I'd listen to him, and that's what I wanted out of my horn. And when you listen to Stan's sound, you don't hear this nasty kind of buzz that saxophone can get. You hear the ring of the horn. You hear the air and you hear the brass ringing.
And this may just be the very first solo Stan Getz ever committed to wax. We can't be certain, but just the possibility that it might be Stan makes it worth hearing. And then some air and brass from Big T.
Tenor saxophone of 17-year-old Stanley Getz for the Stan Kent arrangement of Russian Lullaby.
So there's no mistaking the identity of the sax soloist. He had left when Teagarden folded his band and then joined the Stan Kenton Orchestra, taking one more thing with him from his time with Jack.
Jack Teagarden was a famous alcoholic. I mean, Jack Teagarden was never—he was never completely drunk, and he was never quite sober. But there was always he was always kept his alcohol level was sort of topped up all day, and he finally sort of collapsed at night. And Stan would have to put him to bed, and then wake him up in the morning with a pick-me-up and all that. So the relationship was quite close. But one thing he learned off Teagarden was how to drink. And when he left the Teagarden Orchestra at the age of 17, I mean, he left putting away a bottle of old granddad a day.
In the Kenton band, he learned further skills, not just musical ones. When he left in 1945, he had a heroin habit. Stan Getz's other musical hero was Lester Young, who'd revolutionised the approach to the tenor sax.
Before Lester Young made his appearance, there was only one way of playing the tenor saxophone, and that was the way that Coleman Hawkins did it, which was big, busy, large tone, very forceful playing. Lester Young comes along, the complete opposite. Light tone, highly mobile, not getting into a lot of changes, but floating over them. Younger people who are hearing Lester Young for the first time, people of Stan Getz's generation, they thought, this is the most wonderful sound I've ever heard, this wonderful, glamorous, light, cool sound. And it attracted people of his age.
Ken Kenny Barron, who was Getz's pianist in his last 15 years, also heard some of the favourite stories, including the one where Stan is jamming at the Onyx Club on 52nd Street and Prez hears him play.
After Stan played, I think Lester walked over to him and said, "Nice eyes, Prez, nice eyes," which meant he liked his solo.
And as far as Stan was concerned, that was like the benediction.
And did he used to tell that story all the time later in his career to people?
Yes, he did, yes. And also the last time when he met Prez, just before Prez died, and Prez, he came into the club in Paris, and Prez was sitting at the bar, and Prez pointed at him and says, "Stanley Getz, you're my singer."
And that relates back to the Sonny Stitt.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. Sing me a song.
Stan Getz's sound changed and developed over the decades, but at its heart was always the light and air of Lester Young. The other movement of the 40s which had captivated a generation of musicians was bebop, as Dave Gelly explains.
The great tenor saxophone exponent at the time of bebop, early days of bebop, was Dexter Gordon, who was about the same age as Stan, very charismatic figure and all that. And suddenly Stan Getz heard Dexter and said, "Oh, wow, this is it." And blow me, within a few weeks, he was doing pretty well perfect Dexter Gordon, just handing it back, you know. He heard it, swallowed it, gave it back.
Opus de Bop by the Bebop Boys, featuring Stan Getz. He recorded that while he was in the Benny Goodman Band. Goodman's was still a very popular outfit, but Getz found the discipline wearing and quit in 1946. He headed out to Los Angeles with his new wife Beverly and scuffled, playing, among other bands, with a group which featured four tenor saxophones. This aggregation was signed up, lock, stock and barrel, by Woody Herman to form the core of his second herd. It became known as the Four Brothers Band, though, as Stan Getz revealed to a rather shocked interviewer on American radio, it wasn't the first name.
Well, it wasn't originally titled the Four Brothers. It was titled the Four Mothers.
Oh, really? Got it.
But we couldn't use it that way at the time, so it became Brothers, but now you could say Four Mothers.
Uh-huh. What was it like for you being in such a great section? You know, I don't know how many bands have such a good horn section.
It was a great band. I mean, it's been one thrill after another in this business with the musicians I've played with and the places I've been.